God. Praise God. Let the people of God say amen. Amen. I welcome you to the Bread Broadcast, a Bible teaching program from Eternal Food Evangelistic Organization, where we edify, we exhort, and challenge believers to the Great Commission. Here, we also call sinners to repentance through the gospel of Jesus Christ. Thank you for joining us. Today, we are going to finish off the topic we started last week, how to pray. So today, we are going to do how to pray part two. And the case study is going to be the disciples who later became the apostles, the disciples of Jesus Christ. And our short reading is going to be Matthew chapter 6, verses 11 to 13. So we go back to the same book of Matthew chapter 6 that we read last week. So we finish it today from verses 11 to 13. But before we go any further, let us pray. Dear Lord Jesus, we thank you, we praise you. Thank you, Lord, for your gentleness has made us great. It's by your mercy that we are not consumed. Great, O Lord, is your faithfulness. Father, we ask that your kingdom will come into our hearts through this teaching in the name of Jesus. Open our eyes, Holy Spirit, and let the word be burned into our hearts, that we will be better children in your hands, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right, the foundation text. This came up in my spirit, and I believe the Holy Spirit was ministering to me during the week. The reason we give out foundation text, if you are new to watching us, foundation text gives you a synopsis, a snapshot of what we're going to be talking about in a topic. So that is why we always give the foundation text, because if you are new and you're thinking, okay, you give the foundation text, but you don't usually come back upon it, is to give you a heads up, a snapshot or synopsis of what we are going to be talking about. So foundation text is James chapter 4 verse 3. The book of James chapter 4 verse 3, and I'm going to read. You ask and do not receive because you ask amiss. That is, you ask wrong, that you may spend it on your pleasures. You see, the Bible is saying the reason a lot of people, a lot of Christians, children of God, you pray and your prayer, you don't see anything in result, is because you are asking God to just want to spend it on your personal pleasures, you see. And God is more concerned with people's souls, because people are going to hell every day, you see. So before you start talking to God about giving you money to spend on what you like, have you prayed about your loved ones who need Jesus, your neighbors, you see? So, from last lesson, we talked about four things. We put four principles from two verses of the Lord's Prayer. Number one is alliance, which is identifying ourselves with God and with other believers. Secondly, reverence is approaching God in humility with thanksgiving. Third one is prominence, which is seeking to know God's will concerning our prayer. And the last was obedience, which is choosing to obey whatever God gives as an answer to our prayers. Now, put all of that together, put it in one basket, and label that for God's glory. All right? The first part of the Lord's Prayer has to do with God's glory. Today, the second basket, label that for my own good. Okay? The second part of the Lord's Prayer, that we are going to deal with today is for your own good, is for my own good. And the first in that set is provision. Give us this day our daily bread. Your daily bread may have nothing, listen up, to do with food at all. It may not have anything to do with food, you see. Our daily bread is whatever our concern is. Your daily bread may include a situation that requires an immediate divine intervention. For example, you want to sit down and have your meal. You bless your meal, or you say a grace over your meal before you eat it. And you're saying, is that necessary? Yes, it is. You know why? A lot of people, from just sitting down to eat their lunch or their dinner, they died. They choked on their food and died. So even in something as simple as having our meals, we need God, you see. So that's immediate intervention. Now, your daily bread may be a short-term intervention. For example, you have a job interview in 2 days' time. You're preparing your speech, how to answer questions. You have done your research about the product of that company. You grooming yourself, you get your clothes ready. As you're doing all that, you also need to start praying. Pray for the weather, that the rain doesn't stop you. Pray against traffic, that the traffic doesn't hinder you. Pray against accidents, you see. So you are praying for something in a short term that you need intervention for in 2 days' time. Or your daily bread may also include situations that require us to pray until God intervenes. For example, you are a spinster, you are looking for who to marry, or you're a bachelor, you are trusting God for a good wife, you don't want to marry the wrong girl, you don't want to marry the wrong man. You keep praying, keep asking God every day until He brings you and your man together, or you and your woman, or you have a son that you have lost to drugs, to pornography, to prostitution, or your child is in jail, or a loved one that is going crazy. You keep praying until God touches their heart, you see. That is also daily bread. Now, God has designed life for us never to be needless, you see. There is never going to be a time, as long as you're on this side of eternity, that everything is going to be perfect. It's never going to happen. And the reason God did that is so we don't become independent of God, you see. And God has not done this to make beggars out of us. Rather, it's an act of fatherly love to keep us close to Himself all the time in communion through prayer. Let's go to Psalm 46, verse 1. The book of Psalms, chapter 46, verse 1. God is our refuge and our strength. Hallelujah. A very present help in trouble, you see. Whenever you're in trouble, whenever you have a concern, a worry, God is your present help. God is my present help. He is who we need. He is all we need. All right? The bread giver is also the caregiver. So leave your cares for His help. The bread giver is also the caregiver. So leave your cares for His help. Moving on. Pardon. So we've talked about provision. Remember, this is all for our good in this part, okay? Now we are talking pardon. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Listen up, come close. This is where the rubber meets the road, okay? A child of God may have legitimate need. Are you listening? Follow me, track with me. And be asking according to God's will, all right? But God will not be able to do anything if sin is present in their lives. It's not gonna happen. He's called a holy God for a reason, you see. Sin against God must be confessed. Listen, if you think God is going to grade on the curve, you have something else coming. It's not gonna happen. You say, can that standard be met? It's got to be met. It has to be met. God will not change his standard. And that is why, if as a child of God, you are carnal, you don't live a holy life every day through the Holy Spirit, you're gonna have a tough journey, you see. It's sheer spiritual foolishness to think God will overlook a speck of sin in our lives and give us what we pray for. It's never going to happen. If God did not spare Jesus on the cross, when he carried my sin, when he carried your sin, listen up, it's not gonna spare us, forget it. It's not gonna happen, you see. When we confess, we must be specific. God, I gave that checkout lady a bad look because she was talking to her friend and she was dragging and lagging from checking me out. Forgive me, Lord. Not just, God, if I have sinned against you. No, you have to be specific. God, I lied to my boss. When he asked, what time did I sign in? I said, 2 minutes early. That was a lie. Father, forgive me. You see, be specific. Call the sin by its name and ask God to forgive you. If the Holy Spirit convicts you that you did something, he will pinpoint and lay his hand on it that this is exactly what you did. That is how you know the difference between the condemnation of the devil and conviction of the Holy Spirit. The devil will say, oh, you call yourself a Christian? Look at how you behaved. That's the devil. But the Holy Spirit will say, just for Zion. You cursed that guy in your heart when he cut you off in traffic. You see, it will be specific. And when the Holy Spirit tells you that, don't even bother to pray any other thing. Just begin to ask for forgiveness. Secondly, we need to forgive anyone who could have sinned against us, no matter what they could have done to hurt us. To not forgive others is to sin against God. Somebody said, oh, somebody did something to me, I'm never going to forgive them. Listen, you yourself, you are now in prison. You're in trouble with God because you just turned yourself to God, you see. A genuine believer will not find anything committed against them by others unforgivable, because a genuine Christian, we know the principle, you see. The person who has sinned against you, listen now, has first sinned against God. Let that sink in. The person who has hurt you has first hurt God. How? God said, treat others as you want to be treated. The fact that they hurt you, they already broke God's law. So, do yourself a favor. Take yourself out of that middle. Remove yourself from that problem. Forgive that person. When you forgive, see, this is God here. This is you. And the person that hurt you is here. Okay? When you forgive, you just removed yourself, and God is over here, and the person that hurt you is over here. And if they fail to change, guess what? When God drops his hammer, boom, guess where it's coming? On their head. You've removed yourself, you see. That's the gain of forgiving others. You are better off to forgive that individual, even if they fail to acknowledge that they hurt you. Forgive them anyway. They're not worth your energy, okay? Leave them to God, who has said, vengeance is mine and I will repay. Let God take the vengeance for you. He can do a better job. I'm a living witness. For more on forgiveness, because we can't just deal with that here right now, but we did a good, by the grace of God, job on that in one of our lessons last year. You can go to eternalfood.tv and go to our EFTV and check for Friendly Foe. The topic is Friendly Foe. We did that last year and we talked extensively on forgiveness. We did a little bit of psychology there to help you. Let's go to Matthew 6 verse 15. Matthew 6 15. But if you do not forgive men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. You don't want to stay in God's black book, do you? So forgive people, okay? To pardon others is to turn an offense into an incense. Let me say that again. So beautiful. You see, when there is a sin, when there is hurt in the house, it's offensive to God. Is not only offensive to you, but when you forgive, you change it. When you pardon, you turn that offense into an incense. How is that possible? When you forgive, you have made the heart of God glad, and you have freed your heart from every kind of prison, you see. So to pardon others is to turn an offense into an incense. Moving on. Protection. So we've talked about provision, we have talked about pardon, and now we are talking about protection. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. This is a twofold prayer. One talks about us not committing sin. Sin does not mean, this does not mean God leads us into temptation. God does not tempt with evil, for he himself cannot be tempted with evil, the Bible says. Temptation is the inducement to do wrong. So when we pray, lead us not into temptation, listen up. This is what you are praying. You are praying that God lead my steps away from where I can be induced to do wrong. Okay? That is the meaning of that prayer. Whenever you feel like doing something wrong, it's never from God. No. But when you say, lead us not into temptation, you are saying, God, move my steps away from where I can walk into temptation. Now, the extent to which this prayer is answered depends on our cooperation with the Holy Spirit. For example, you're a man. You went to Walmart and you're about to check out. You are on the line and there's this lady in front of you, gladly dressed, almost naked. Now, as a child of God, I'm sure of one thing. The Holy Spirit will tell you to look away. And even the strength to look away as a man is given to you by the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit will tell you to walk. Look for another checkout. Don't stand behind her. No. You don't want to take that into your mind and it becomes a junk, you see. Or you work at a company and this pen belongs to your workplace. Let's just use this as an example. And you pack a few, you're trying to put it in your purse, and the Holy Spirit will tell you straight away, that is stealing, don't do that. Put it back. You see, that is the Holy Spirit not leading you into temptation. He's moving you away from that evil. Now, the answer to that prayer is now dependent on you. If you obey, if you don't, you put yourself into temptation. Now, the other part of that prayer, but deliver us from evil, is to ask God for wisdom to protect us from external sin of others, so as not to share in their evil, in the evil of their sin. An example that came to my mind was a very good sister of mine, and this was some years back, and a lady went to this my sister, and she gossiped about another sister in their fellowship, and my sister told this gossip as she was leaving, I'm going to call Sister ABC that you just gossiped about, and I'm going to tell her everything you just told me. And the gossip, of course, she couldn't leave anymore. She's like, oh, wait a minute. No, you don't have to tell her. And she said, no, why did you come to tell me if you don't want me to tell her? You see, that was the last time that gossip went to my sister's house, you see. Now, if somebody is coming to you and straight off, they say, they are telling you, did you hear what happened to XYZ? This is how God helps you with that prayer, because the Holy Spirit will give you the wisdom. You can say, no, I didn't hear what happened to her, but if it's something that you know I can repeat, when I see her, you can tell me. If they're there to gossip, guess what? They will tell you, oh, don't worry, never bother, you see. But if they're there genuinely concerned about that person, they will tell you, and you can now call the other person up. Oh, Sister XYZ told me this is going on with you. Is there anything I can do? You see. But if they come to you and they didn't start off with, did you hear about what happened to XYZ? You talked about the weather, and from there they drift into gossiping. As soon as they finish, before they leave, let them know. Do like my sister. I'm going to call Sister ABC, and I will let her know that you told me this about her. I can pray with her as well. I promise you, you will never see them again. You see, that is God giving you wisdom. Or you're a married man and a lady is asking you to go for lunch with her at work. I'm sorry. I know of one of us here, if a lady wants to hug him, he always tells them, oh, no, I'm sorry. I only hug my wife, you see. That is the wisdom of God. That is that prayer, deliver us from evil. So when we pray that is what we are praying. Let's go to Proverbs chapter 1, verse 10. The book of Proverbs 1:10. My child, if sinners try to entice you, do not consent, you see. Don't even bargain about it. One young man in our ministry said, don't engage into argument or conversation with the devil. You see? Don't. Just walk off. Ephesians 5:11. And I'm using the NET Bible version. I like the way it's rendered. Do not participate in the unfruitful deeds of darkness, but rather expose them. You see, don't join them, expose them. To be careful about our character is to be careful about our hereafter. Listen, every word we have said, everything we have done, every thought will be open when we get before God. So to be careful about our character is to be careful about our hereafter. Moving on. Adoration. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and glory forever. Amen. This helps us to remember that we are not in control. Have you noticed that lately? Huh? You are not the general manager of the world, all right? And I'm not. And I'm so grateful that I'm not. We do not have the power to do anything, which is why we are asking God for help in the first place, you see. And when God answers the prayer, it is to remind us who gets the credit. Don't you go busting your chest and bouncing your chest and saying, oh yeah, I did it. You did what? No, you didn't do anything. God did it, you see. Amen or amen is another name for Jesus. It also translates to, so let it be. Whatever, listen now, we stick the name of Jesus to, must agree with the word of God and the character of Jesus. Listen up. If you bring some Hollywood movies to me and ask me to put my signature to that you want to show some kids, I promise you it's not gonna happen. Oh no, because I don't believe in Hollywood, really. I do not. I'm not a fan. So whatever you are going to pray about, make sure before you slap the name of Jesus on it, like his signature, it is in line with his character. When we complete our prayer with thanksgiving, it has a way of strengthening our faith, because now we have hope for an answer to come from God. Having poured out our hearts to God, we feel light and we become calm in our spirit. Let's quickly read the story of Hannah, the mother of Samuel, from the book of 1 Samuel, chapter 1, verses 17 to 18. 1 Samuel, chapter 1, verses 17 and following. Then Eli answered and said, go in peace, and the God of Israel grant your petition which you have asked of him. And she said, let your maidservant find a favor in your sight. So the woman went away and ate, and her face was no longer sad. You see, what happened to Hannah? She had poured her heart out to God, and now she feels light, and she's no longer sad. So she ate. You see, a calm spirit produces a quiet mouth. Let's say that again. When you have problems, the next thing for you to do is not to jump on the phone, jump into your prayer room, because a calm spirit produces a quiet mouth. What have we done so far? What is the Lord's model, prayer model, for his followers? Part two, which is for our own good. Number one is provision. This is presenting the actual problem for which we are praying. Number two is pardon. This is confessing our sins so they don't hinder our prayers. Protection. This is asking for divine guidance and wisdom to avoid evil. Adoration. This is thanking God with hope that he will answer us. Now, as a believer, all we need to go do now is practice. Okay? Now, if you are an unbeliever, you are unsaved, you are yet to give your life to Jesus, this can't help you. Because Jesus is not yet your father. But that can change. Okay? So, a link is coming up. If you want to become a child of God, because this is all for your good, okay? You follow that link after I finish praying, and we will meet you there. Alright? Father, we thank you. God, you are so beautiful. Thank you for speaking to our hearts. Lord, we ask for the grace to practice. And Lord, for those who are going to give their hearts to you, Father, open their hearts, O Lord. Let them understand the depth of your love. For in Jesus' name, I will pray. Amen and amen. I will see you next week, if Jesus has not split the sky open.